Hello friends, welcome to CYAS. How are you? I hope you are doing well. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC Civil Services, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So friends, we have also started a series in which what we do, we daily analyze the editorials of your Indian Express. And we daily make two videos of Indian Express. That is, one is of your editorial analysis and other is of your news analysis. And news analysis is a combined video of the news analysis of The Hindu as well as your Indian Express. So friends, let's see what are the articles that are to be discussed today. So this is the first article that has been given over here. You can see the heading, three mistakes and two ironies. So I have broadly highlighted the points that are to be discussed here, but I request you to not read these points, just listen to my viewpoint. But I want to say not my viewpoint, but to the viewpoint of the author, that what he wants to say. You are not required to read the points that I have highlighted. You can see them in the newspaper. So this, the purpose of the video is to just so that you can listen about the important points. So friends, this article is about the recent ban by the Election Commission of India on the Prime Minister Narendra Modi's biopic. That is, I think, I don't know its name, but it is, I think it is named by Narendra Modi. So this biopic is basically the story of Prime Minister Narendra Modi as a PM. So here the author, the broad viewpoint of the author is that the Election Commission has prohibited the biopic, but its prohibition is too broad in scope, and it also carries multiple issues with it. So we have to highlight here the main issues. So friends, let me tell you that at the first instance, the author says that the ban appears to be well intentional, because it kind of ensures that the level playing field among the candidates is not violated. For example, if certain candidate is for example in this case the Narendra Modi, if he has the biopic, then it is very much possible then during the model code of conduct he will be able to kind of influence the opinion of people, more people, by way of this biopic, and this will disturb the level playing field. So this biopic is basically to ensure that this level playing field is not disturbed. While listening to this point, it seems that it is good, but the author says that there is very much problem in this view, because friends, first of all, and the author wants to say the Election Commission is not able to identify the basic difference between an advertisement and a film. So here the biopic is seen as an advertisement which convinces the the target audience, but the author says that the Election Commission has failed to identify this difference, because an advertisement is a kind of imposed thing, because for example, if you are watching the TV or any other gadget you are using, so if any advertisement does just pop up then it is involuntary. You don't want to see it, but you are shown this. For example, if you have paid the money for the channel, but for watching the content of the channel, but the channel is running the advertisements, then the advertisement is kind of a imposed thing on you. But rather, film is a very different thing, because film is a kind of, it is not imposed. The individuals who want to see the film, they voluntarily invest their time and money in it, so they have a kind of interest in that particular film. So this is the basic difference which the author says that Election Commission failed to identify. So in case of film, the target audience in this context, the author says, is very much less, because it is not imposed on everybody. So it is very much voluntary to see. So in this, the author wants to make the point that it depends upon the individual, that whether he wants to see the film or not. So it is not necessary that these types of biopics they further the political agenda. So another thing the author wants to say is that the election commission's order is quite it is disproportionally broad. Why broad, friends? Because the author says that the ban is there on the complete film and not on some parts of it. So the author says that the election commission could have identified certain parts which it could have perceived to be furthering the political agenda, and it could have recommended the cuts in such scenes. So, but the plain ban on the film is not desirable. So this is also the second point that the author wants to make. And the next point is also that the author wants to say that this case is also a kind of showing that election commission trivializes the intelligence capability of the individual. For example, friends, if you are seeing a film, then certainly if you know that it may be fictional, there may be fictional things in it, there can be politically motivated scenes in it, so you can identify and you can see with critical angle a film. But whereas in advertisement, the maker, the producer assumes the producer kind of says that it is true. So in advertisement, truth is said to be right, and in this context, but the film is if in the film this is not the case. So that's why the author says that okay, this ban is wrong. And also the author says that okay, if election commission bans this biopic, then it is a disquieting precedent for the future. Because in the future also, the books could be the target, as well as other films could be the soft targets of the public institutions in India. So this is basically, so in this context, the author says the election commission, whereas it has shown its considerable authority in banning this, in ensuring that the film is not released, but at the same time it has failed to curb the divisive and your hateful speeches that are delivered by the politicians across the spectrum, whether they are of the BJP or for that matter of the Congress. So in this context, author also wants to say censorship promotes further censorship, because the recent censorship that has been imposed by election commission, it further the cause of the censorship itself, because Supreme Court has now demanded the reason for it, that why the censorship is there, and it is to be submitted in under sealed cover. So there is nothing that is to be submitted in sealed cover. So but this ensures that transparency is not there in the process. So in this way, the author says the election commission order is not fair, and in this context, this is about your article, so you can read it yourself. So the heading of the article was 3 Mistakes and 2 Ironies, and let's move on to the next article. Next is Grounded. So friends, this article is in the context of halt in their practice activities of Jet Airways. So friends, Jet Airways, let me tell you that it was the second largest passenger carrier as recently as January, but now it has flied for the last time on Wednesday, and the company's financial difficulties reached very high level. So it is not the case that Jet Airways came to halt in certain manner, because financial difficulties were there in the public domain from March 2018, when this Jet Airways started the deferring dispersal of salaries, and also after that it defaulted on the aircraft lease rentals and also on the repayment towards the lenders in October and December. So in this context, the author wants to say okay, the fault is with the lenders to see these signs of trouble, because if there were such signs of trouble and they were visible as early as in March 2018, then it was necessary on the part of lenders that they could have taken appropriate action, and they could have come up with appropriate plans so that this the operation appropriations are not halted. So, but the lenders did not kind of they ignored these signs, and the chairman, the founder chairman, that is Naresh Goyal, continued to the airline on the airline's board till March 25 in 2019. So the author says ki if there were financial irregularities, then it was required that lenders could have come together and could have removed the Naresh Goyal from the management of the Jet Airways, and they could have come up with appropriate plan. But this doesn't happen. And also the author says that this happened in the context of when India has a proper insolvency and bankruptcy court. So it is striking why this option was not exercised early. So other thing the author wants to say this delay has caused multiple damages, because now the banks have finally removed the Naresh Goyal, forced the Naresh Goyal to step down, but now they have kind of they called for the expression of interest from other investors to bring the Jet Airways from the financial difficulty and to resume its operations. But now the investors which would be investing in this Jet Airways, which is running which is under high debt and is not able to maintain its financial obligations, then it is very much possible that the expression of interest from investors will, if the investors would demand a kind of the high writing off of the loans that are given by the lender. So it is not possible that some investor ABC will come and will invest in the Jet Airways and will take the obligation of repaying all the loans that the Jet Airways has taken from lenders. So certainly he or she will demand substantial write-offs. So this is a loss to the banking industry, because already banks are under stress. So there is a lot of problem of non-performing assets, and also there are stressed assets. So in this context, when the banking sector of the economy is already under pressure, so this is not a good sign. And also another thing the author wants to highlight here is that the bidding will now reduce the valuation, and had it been done earlier 6 months back, the valuation could have been much higher. So in this context also, the author says that the responsibility is also with the government, because there were also public sector banks that is for example SBI, State Bank of India, and public your Punjab National Bank that provided loans to these to this Jet Airways. But friends, the other important thing which the author wants to highlight is also of the ordeal of now the 16,000 employees of this Jet Airways, because now they are rendered unemployed or they are rendered idle, because the operations have been halted and there is no clue about what would happen to them, what would happen to their jobs. So other thing the author wants to highlight is that after 1991 economic liberalization, this Jet Airways was a symbol of this liberalization. But now, as we know, that Indigo, that is domestic carrier, and it has already 43% plus market share. In this scenario, if a particular airline operator, in this case the Jet Airways, which is the second largest carrier in India, if the operations of it are halted, then it would certainly damage the consumer interest, because there will be a tendency to monopolize these airline operations by the Indigo now, because Indigo now already it has 43% of the market share, and it would amount to more monopolization by the Indigo. So this is not in interest of your consumer. So in this context, author says now the time is there, ideal time is there to do away with the 49% ownership limit that is there for Indian airlines by the foreign carriers. So this is this was all about this article. And next article is when Rahul descends. So here in this context, friends, this is a kind of a little bit political article, but as some I can say some teachers say that we don't have to, you don't have to read the political articles. Let me tell you, friends, you don't have to get political, but you must have some kind of opinion about the issues that are going on in India. So whether they are political or apolitical. So certainly apolitical issues you have to read, but also some political issues you have to read. So have to, so that you can form an apolitical opinion about a particular issue. So this is very much important, because otherwise your preparation is not quite will not be comprehensive, and you will not have that much of understanding of the things that are happening in the country. So now this article, when Rahul descends, this article is in the context of recent election campaigning that is taking place for the Lok Sabha. So I will not go into much detail of this article, the author wants to make a point here that the Rahul Gandhi, the president of Congress, has remarked that all those who have become economic fugitives, who have left the country and frauded the system, they have the Modi in their last name, in their names. So in this context, the author says that this is not a good approach, because this amounts to categorizing a whole community by a kind of label that is not good. So for that matter, the author says that there are multiple type of individuals in a community, and we can't say that every individual is a thief, or for that matter of a particular quality. So this is a kind of author wants to say this is not the kind of comments that is required from the leaders, because this denies the individual his agency, because it completely paints him or her in the context of your collective color of the identity. So this is about your fourth article. So now this article, friends, this is also important, a manifesto for health. So this article is also in the context of the recent elections that are in the process, the recent Lok Sabha election. So here the author has come up with the major problem in India, that is of healthcare. So here the author starts with saying that the healthcare has come into the political debate, because earlier the healthcare was not seen in political debate, but now by the launching of Jan Arogya Yojana by current incumbent government, and also by the recent manifesto of the Congress, in which it promised bringing Right to Healthcare Act, and the author wants to say that this issue of healthcare has come up in the political ambit of political debates. So in this context, so author says that this is a good point, but also says that there are multiple problems in India's healthcare, and there are multiple issues like lack of quality and affordable healthcare. So in this context, this is a bad sign. So for this purpose, the author has come up with certain points that must be executed so that the India's healthcare could be transformed in a comprehensive manner. So there is a kind of manifesto, that is People's Health Manifesto, which has been prepared by a coalition of health sector organizations and activists in India. So there are certain points that have been made by them. So let's see what are the points. So the first point the author wants to say, the right to healthcare should be adopted at the center as well as state level, so that India can ensure now the universal health coverage. So the point is to move towards the right based approach. So if there is a, for example, there is also now we have an employment act, education as we have right based approach towards education by the Right to Education Act 2019. In similar way, the author says ki this type of act is needed in the healthcare also. So he says that there should be right to healthcare legislation at the center as well as state level, and thus there should be universal health coverage of your of your healthcare program. So in this context, author says that this only not only demands the legislation but also comprehensive strengthening of public health service providers at all levels. And the second thing the author wants to say is there is quite now there is a very much low where there is in India we there is the government share on the healthcare is very low. It spends just 1.2% of its GDP on the healthcare, which needs to be improved. So the author says that there must be a medium and long term goal. For example, the author says that in next 5 years it must reach to 3.5% of the GDP, and then in medium term it must reach 5% of the GDP. So there is clearly the author wants to say that there must be increase in the public health expenditure. And the third thing the author wants to say is the strengthening and reforming of public health services with increased staff and infrastructure. So friends, now our public health infrastructure faces a huge shortage of skilled manforce and human resources. So here it is required that it is strengthened with the increased availability of the staff as well as infrastructure. And also the author says that there must be provision of free essential medicines and diagnostics to all patients in public health facilities. So in this context, the author gives the example of certain states that have a such type of system of free medicines as well as diagnostic services to all the patients. So for example, the models followed in Tamil Nadu and the Kerala and Rajasthan. And the other thing, the fourth point the author wants to say is that there must be a comprehensive health sector human resource policy. So what is comprehensive health sector human resource policy? In this context, the author says there must be a kind of, we can say, a proper upgraded skill training of the workforce that is engaged in healthcare, and also there must be fair wages and social security as well as decent working conditions for all public health services staff. So here the author also says, also goes to the extent that the ASHAs and your Anganwadi workers, the services of these must be regularized. And other thing the author wants to say, okay, there must be a comprehensive kind of community based monitoring of the services provided. So there must be a kind of a social audit at the community level, so that the community can plan what are the services, healthcare services that are needed by them, and what is the level of their availability, and they must be able to monitor it. And also there must be proper grievance redressal systems should be put in place to ensure social accountability. And the other thing the author wants to say is that there must be universal healthcare system. So now, as of now, we have Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, in which approximately 50,000 crore people are expected to be benefited, in this context, author says that this approach must be abundant in favor of universal healthcare system. That is, each and every individual must be covered. So, other thing the author wants to say is that there must be proper regulation of private sector, because currently the government has completely failed in the regulation of private sector, which overcharges and follow unethical practices. And in this context, there is a very, very serious concern that the regulation of the private sector is not there. So, there must be proper regulation. And in this context, the author says that there must be a proper act, that is Clinical Establishment Act, in all states, and it must register all the private healthcare providers, and there must be a proper charter of patients' rights that must be observed by these private healthcare service providers. So also there must be a grievance redressal mechanism to patients, so that the private sector could be held accountable for any type of misadventures. And the next point author wants to the eighth point and the last point the author wants to emphasize is that there must be essential medicines as well as medicinal devices that must be subject to price regulation depending upon the cost of their manufacturing. So there are multiple medicines which are essential, and there are multiple medicinal devices which are essential, but they are unaffordable, but they have been their price have been kept at a very high price, and the needy are not able to afford to afford these medicinal devices and medicines. So in this context, author wants to say there must be a proper uniform code for pharmaceutical marketing practices also, so that there must be to curb the unethical marketing practices, as well as to ensure that the medicines under the generic name is sold, and also the doctors must be encouraged to write the prescriptions under the generic name only. So this would ensure that the patients would be able to buy generic medicines which are as much effective as your standard medicines, but they are quite low in price. So other things the author wants to highlight is here is that there must also be a focus on the health indicators, the health determinants. For example, traditional social determinants. For example, your healthy nutrition, water, cleaned water supply, sanitation, and healthy environment. And in this context, author also adds that there must also be focus on the recent new health health determinants. For example, your pollution, water pollution level, air pollution level, as well as addiction. So there must be proper planning keeping these traditional social determinants as well as new social determinants to ensure that that people remain healthy. So in this context, the author says that it is not that much difficult to increase the expenditure and to reboot the entire healthcare system, because there are many countries that have low income or middle income, such as Thailand or Brazil and Sri Lanka, but they have such systems in place which provides universal healthcare, as well as there is a considerable expenditure by the government also. So this is all about your this editorial of your manifesto for health. So these are the articles, important articles of today, friends, because no other article is that much important. There is one article that has to be discussed, but that article will be discussed in the next video, in which there will be news analysis. So if you like this video, if you like the analysis, then do ensure that you share it with your friends, and also ensure that you like it, and also ensure that you subscribe to our channel, and do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications about the updates that we do on our channels. Thank you, friends. Have a very nice day.